Hello everyone, in this video we'll be discussing about orthopedic appliances. So when it comes to orthopedic appliances, what is the basic difference between the orthodontic appliances, that is the removable and fixed appliances, and the orthopedic appliances? We should know that first. So basically, orthodontic appliances, what are these? These are generally fixed appliance and removable appliance. Now these appliances generally cause the movement of teeth. So basically they will be helping you to correct the position of teeth. While when it comes to the orthopedic appliance, they are basically concerned with the deeper craniofacial skeletal tissue. So they are concerned with deeper skeletal tissue of the craniofacial skeletal tissue. So these fixed and removable appliances will be giving light forces anywhere between 50 to 100, while these, which will be modifying the growth of the bones, that could be maxilla or the mandible, basically they are used for maxilla, so that could change the growth pattern of the, or modify the growth pattern of the jawbone as well as the maxilla, so there will be more force requirement. So generally force is more than 400 gram, which is required for the which is given by the orthopedic appliances. So what are the kinds of the orthopedic appliances? We have the headgear, the face mask, and chin cusp. These are the various type of orthopedic appliances which we'll be reading in this video. Now what should be the basis of the orthopedic appliances? So basically the force applied to tooth has the potential to radiate towards the basal bone or towards the bone in which it is inserted, and that can cause the changes in the skeletal, provided you have enough force which can cause the changes in the skeleton also. So what should be that force? That should be high force, or the heavy force that should be more than 400 gram, and that forms the basis of the orthopedic appliances. So basically we'll be using the teeth as the handles to transmit the heavy forces which are coming from the head gears or the different type of orthopedic appliances, and that will be transmitted to different skeletal structures, and that can cause the modification of those skeletal tissues, and that's how you get the changes in the craniofacial bones of in which the teeth are embedded, right? So let's start with the different types of orthopedic appliance. First we'll be seeing the head gears. So whenever headgears comes to your mind, you have to be you have to have one thing instantly, that it is going to restrict the growth of maxilla. Okay, so headgear is always concerned with restriction of growth of maxilla or maxillary growth. So this should be the concept which you have to remember about the headgear. So whenever some treatment modality is asked, if like class 2 malocclusion is asked, the skeletal one, then you can think about the restriction of growth of maxilla or how it will be affecting on the maxilla also, right? So here headgears will be using to restrict the growth of the maxilla, and it is the most commonly used orthopedic appliances. So out of all the three which we are going to discuss, the headgears are the most commonly used appliance. Okay, so it basically corrects the skeletal malocclusion, as well as it can distalize the maxilla. So it can put the maxilla in a backward direction also. So headgear face bow assembly is generally used, and in the headgear we'll be using the face bow. So what are the component of face bow we'll be discussing? So face bow, it is generally of two types. One is the inner outer bow type. So what is that? It consists of outer bow, as the name indicates here, and inner bow, as well as a junction that joins inner and the outer face bow. So how these, what will be the function of outer bow? Basically it is made up of 1.5 mm stiff round wire, and it is contoured around the face. Okay, so outer bow will be around the face. It can be short, medium, or long in relation to the inner bow. So what will be the function of inner bow? Inner bow will be generally inserted in the molar tubes or in the tubes where it can fit and it can apply the forces. So it is generally found intraorally. So it is made up of 0.045 inch or 0.052 inch and it is basically made of stainless steel wire. So it is inserted into the buccal tube on the maxillary first molar, where it will be using the maxillary first molar as the handle to transmit the forces to the maxilla. So the inner outer face bow type, here we have the outer face bow. This one is the outer face bow. This one is the inner face bow, and this is the junction that will be connecting both outer and the inner face bow. Now there is something called force element. So this one, basically this one is a force element. So it will be basically connecting the neck strap or the head cap to the face bow. So there will be holes that will be engaging the hooks of the face bow. Okay, and that will be connecting the neck strap or the head cap. So this one is basically the head cap. So that will be providing the anchorage, that will be taking the anchorage from the head, of course. And this will be the neck strap that will be taking the anchorage or the support from neck. So again, I'll try to explain this or review it. This one is a inner outer face bow, inner face bow, outer face bow. This is head strap, this is neck strap, and this is the force element which combines, which joins the neck strap or the head strap to the face bow. We also have J hook type of face bow also, where you will be engaging this hook to the force element, and that can be the J shape can be appreciated here. So these are the various elements. So force element, it generally connects the face bow to the head cap or the neck strap, as we have already explained. And head cap or the cervical strap, it takes anchorage from the rigid bones of the skull in the case of head cap, or from the back of the neck in the case of cervical strap. Now based on the type of anchorage, we can divide the headgear into 5 different types. So we have the cervical headgear, then we have the occipital headgear, the combination headgear, the vertical pull headgear, and the asymmetrical pull type of headgear. Let's start with the cervical headgear. In the cervical headgear, the anchorage will be coming from the nape of neck. Okay, so as the name indicates cervical, so we should get that it takes the anchorage from the nape of neck. Now it causes extrusion of the maxillary molars, okay, and it leads to increase in lower facial height. Basically it increases or it encourages the vertical growth, okay, because maxilla will be somewhere here, right, and the anchorage will be somewhere here like this, okay. So we'll be getting the anchorage from the neck of the patient. Just try to imagine this. So this will be the actual vector, and due to this particular vector there will be extrusion of the maxillary molars that leads to increase in lower facial height, and that will move maxilla as well as the maxillary dentition in a distal as well as inferior direction. So if you break the components of this vector, it will be inferior as well as the distal direction. So that will be taking the maxilla as well as the dentition, the maxillary dentoalveolar structure, to the distal and inferior side. So the indication for this will be low mandibular angle, because the low mandibular angle which is seen in the horizontal grower, we want to grow the vertical axis of the lower face. So that's why vertical, it generally encourages the vertical growth. Now occipital headgear, so these will be taking the anchorage from the back of the head, and there will be the force, the component of force will be in the superior direction as well as in distal direction. So these are also known as the high pull headgear, because most of the force is in the vertical direction, and that too superiorly. So where are you going to use these? So in those patients where you don't want the vertical height of the face to grow. So what can be those patients? There can be the patient like patient of open bite, and we have the class 2 patient which are already vertical grower, right? So you don't want to increase the vertical length. So how you'll be doing that? You simply use this occipital headgear that will be restricting the vertical growth of the maxilla, right? So in the vertical, there won't be lengthening in the vertical dimensions of the maxilla, and that will be restricting that particular growth, and hence we can use in case of open bite as well as in case of long face, where the patient is having long face, and the class 2 patient. Of course, we are using the headgears in class 2 mainly. So the occipital head gear, again let me give you the dimensions here. Suppose this is the maxilla and we'll be taking the anchorage from the back of the head, right, somewhere here, right? So this will be the vector and the components will be superior as well as that will be a distal. Although since these will be having more force vertically, right, so it is adjusted in such a way that it will be having more vertical component of the force and hence it will be restricting the vertical growth of the maxilla, right? So it produces distal and the superior directed forces on maxilla as well as the maxillary dentition, and it decreases the vertical development of the maxilla and hence is of immense importance and immense use in the patient with, who are having long face and they are having class 2 malocclusion, as well as in case of open bite also will be using the occipital headgear. Now we have the vertical pull headgears. So as the name indicates, they will be having all the force directed vertically in a superior direction. So they'll be taking anchorage from the parietal region of the cranium. Okay, so how you are going to use this type of what will be the indication basically? So whenever there is excess of the anterior region of the maxilla or you have the gummy smile and you want to treat it orthopedically, then that will be causing the intrusion of the anterior part of the maxilla. Try to imagine this, if we are giving the vertical superior forces and after some time there will be movement of the anterior tooth or the anterior region of the maxilla in a vertical direction, then there will be a tilt like this, right? So that is called a counterclockwise movement of the maxilla. For example, this is the maxilla and we are giving the vertical pull headgear, and that will be causing the intrusion of this anterior segment of the maxilla. So it would look like something like this. Okay. So this will be basically a movement in this direction, and this is a anti-clockwise direction, or we call it as counterclockwise movement of the maxilla. So vertical pull headgears, let me revise it again, obtain anchorage from the parietal region. It produces vertically directed forces on maxilla as well as the maxillary dentition, and it can produce the intrusive forces on anterior region of maxilla that can cause the counterclockwise movement of the maxilla. What are the indications for that? As I have already discussed, that the vertical maxillary anterior, if it is in excess or the patient is suffering from the gummy smile, then you can go with this particular type of headgear. Now let's start with the meritus prefect. So there are various points for the cervical headgear. Let's see the whole concept here. For example, the normally the maxilla is little bit tilted like this. Okay. So there will be dentition also in the maxilla. Okay. Now what happens? Suppose this is the center of rotation of the maxillary skeleton and this is the center of rotation of the dentition. Let's hypothesize this thing. Okay, now what happens if the line of force, we know the cervical force will be like this, if you are taking the anchorage from the cervical region or the nape of the neck, then the whole force will be like this and the components of this vector will be divided into two, that is the distal direction and the inferior direction. Till now it should be clear. Now, if the force passes through the center of the resistance of the maxillary skeleton itself, that will be causing a bodily movement or the translatory movement of the maxilla itself without causing any rotation. What happens if it is above both the center of resistance of the skeleton, that is the maxilla as well as the dentition, then there will be a tilting. Okay, there will be a rotation of course, and it will be rotating the distal part like this. Okay, so it will be, if it will be rotating like this, there will be a anti-clockwise rotation. Okay, that means the maxilla will be rotated in an anti-clockwise direction and it will change its direction and will be rotated like this and it will become flat. Okay, so line of action of the force, if it pass above the center of the resistance of maxilla as well as the maxillary dentition, then it will be causing the anti-clockwise or the counter-clockwise movement of the maxilla as well as the maxillary dentition that will lead to the flat occlusal plane. Then we have the third condition where the line of force is passing below both, below the center of resistance of maxilla as well as the dentition, then it will be causing what it will be causing? It will be causing the tilting of this in this direction. That means the clockwise direction it will be tilted. And if it is tilted more in the clockwise direction, it will be further causing the steepen, this whole maxilla will be further steepens in the anterior direction like this. So it would be somewhat like this, right? So line of action, if passes below the center of the resistance of maxilla as well as the maxillary dentition, then what will happen? There is a clockwise movement of the maxilla as well as the maxillary dentition, and the occlusal plane will further tilt downwards or in the clockwise direction. That means it steepens further. Now one condition could be that the line of force will be passing in between. That means it will be below the center of resistance of the maxilla and above the center of resistance of the whole dentition. So what will happen in that condition? The clockwise movement of the maxilla will occur, because if it is below the center of resistance of maxilla, it will be in clockwise direction, but at the same time it will be above the center of resistance of the dentition. That means the dentition will be moved in a counterclockwise direction. Okay, so same way, if we have two, this is for maxilla and this is for dentition, and the line of force is like this, then there will be clockwise movement of the maxilla itself, but it is above the dentition center of resistance. That means there will be counterclockwise movement of the dentition, and that's how the line of action makes difference while we are using the cervical headgear. So you have to keep in mind the dentitions as well as the skeleton's center of resistance while applying the forces. So line of action of the force passing below the center of the resistance of the maxilla but above the maxillary dentition, it will be causing what? Clockwise movement of the maxilla and counterclockwise movement of the maxillary dentition. So in the occipital headgear, the occipital pull headgear, you will be getting the anchorage from the back of the head basically. So suppose this could be the person and this is the back of the head. So and this here we have the maxilla. Okay, so actual tilt of the maxilla is somewhat like this, right? Now what happens, there will be one strap here and one strap here. So overall this would be somewhere here, the vector would be here like this. Now what will happen if the center of resistance of the maxilla is here and the line of force passes through the center of resistance of the maxilla, then what will happen? There will be translation of the maxilla and it will be in a upwards as well as the distal direction. If the line of action of the force pass between above the center of the resistance of both, that is the maxilla as well as the dentition, then this will be like this, here like this, and that would be basically moving the whole assembly in a further anti-clockwise direction. If the line of action of the force is below the center of the resistance here for both of these dentition as well as the skeleton, so it will be moving this in a clockwise direction. See this, this would be in a clockwise direction. So it is same as in the cervical headgear for both the conditions. So basically you will be having all the condition same as that of the cervical, just here there will be superior direction, movement in a superior direction. Now the vertical pull headgear, if the line of the action of the force passes from the anterior segment, again I'll just make the maxilla and it would be little bit tilted also, no, like this, and here will be the center of resistance of this as well as the center of resistance of the dentition. So if the line of the action will be passing from, it is a vertical one, so the force, overall force will be in the vertical direction. So if the line of the force is passing anterior to the center of resistance of these both, then it will be of course in a anti-clockwise direction. So counterclockwise direction it will be. So in the anterior segment, there will be counterclockwise movement of the maxilla and the maxillary anterior teeth will further intrude and the deep bite will be relieved. Line of action of the force, if it passes from the posterior region, then of course there will be a clockwise direction from the posterior region itself, and there is a clockwise movement of the maxilla, and the maxillary posterior teeth will further intrude, and due to the intrusion of these posterior teeth, the bite of the patient will be closing. So now coming to the uses of the headgear, the first use where we have the orthopedic effect. So it is generally used for restriction of the downward and forward growth of the maxilla, right? And generally we use more than 400 grams of force. 350 to 400 grams is also recommended in each side for minimum of 12 to 14 hours a day. So what will be the duration of the wearing of these headgears? That will be 12 to 14 hours a day. It is a potential question for your exam, as well as 350 to 400 gram will be producing the orthopedic effects here. Now for anchorage augmentation, if you want to use, then you will be using it for a lower amount of force, that is 300 gram, and the timing also will be varying. That means timing of wearing will be 10 hours per day. If you want to distalize the molars, then you will be wearing it for 14 hours per day, and for molar rotation and use in space maintenance also we can use these headgears. Now coming to the next orthopedic appliance, that is known as the face mask. So whenever you are reading about the face mask, just think opposite to the headgear. So for headgear it was restriction of the growth of maxilla, here it will be enhancement or advancement of growth of maxilla. So this is the basic difference, and that's why it is also known as reverse pull headgear. That means it will be pulling in the opposite direction of the headgear, and that's why it will be having effect opposite to that of the headgear. And what will be the effect? It will be the growth of the maxilla in forward direction, and basically it pulls the maxilla in a forward direction. Now the face masks, it was for the first reverse pull headgear or the face mask was used by Hickman in 1972. It is a potential question for exam, and the force required is, that is 450 gram, that is 1 pound. Direction of force is 15 to 20 degree downwards and forward pull to the occlusal plane. So it will be in a tilt of 15 to 20 degree in a downward pull, right? Now what are the indications? The most important indication here is the growing patient. You are going to use any of the orthopedic appliance in a growing patient only, right? But the patient which have the prognathic mandible and retrusive maxilla. So you want to increase the growth of maxilla to make the profile, the relationship of the maxilla and mandible of the similar degree, right? Now it is used for bending the condylar neck for stimulating the TMJ adaptations to the posterior displacement of the chin. So whenever you have displaced the chin in a backward direction, then also for rearranging the or stimulating the TMJ and to adapt the TMJ, you are going to use this face mask. It is used for selective rearrangement of the palatal shells also in case of cleft patients. In correction of the post-surgical relapse after osteotomy, suppose you have done the osteotomy and there is a relapse, then you can try the face mask also. And to treat certain accessory problems with nose morphologies like lateral deviation of the nose, there also you can try the face masks. Now what should be the duration of wearing the face mask, and what should be the appropriate force which should be acquired there, which should be there? So low forces like 250 gram per side, then the duration of wearing will be increased, that will be around 18 months. If you are using very high force value like 1600 to 3000 gram, then treatment is required for 4 to 21 days only. Frequency of use of face mask is generally 12 to 14 hours per day. Again, it is a potential question for your exam. Now, starting with the types of face mask, the first type is the Delayer's face mask. So here you have to see, remember this image, because they ask the image based question by giving you the direct images also. Okay. So this is a Delayer's face mask. It was popularized by Delayer in 1960s, and it uses the forehead support and the chin support. Okay. And there will be a wire framework that will be supporting or connecting these two, and that would be somewhat squarish. So this is the method to identify this. You will have one forehead support, one chin support, and squarish wire framework, and that is basically the delayer face mask. Now the modifications of the delayer type of face mask is the Tubinger face mask and the Pettit type of face mask. So the Tubinger face mask, earlier we had the whole rectangular framework. Here only the two rods will be coming and they will be adjusting in such a way that they do not interfere with the nose. So this is how you can identify the Tubinger face mask. It looks like a tube here, right? So it is a modified type of the delayer face mask, and two rods will originate from the chin cup. Okay, this will be the chin cup, and it will be running in the midline and is shaped in such a way that it avoids the interference of the nose and it connects the forehead step also. So you can remember this by a mnemonic, that it looks like a tube, and that's why it could be a Tubinger face mask. Then we have the Pettit type of face mask, in which we use only single rod, okay, for connecting the chin cup and the forehead part, right? So this is also a modification of delayer face mask only. It consists of chin cup and the forehead cup with a single rod running in the midline from the forehead to the chin cup in such a way, it is bended in such a way that it doesn't interfere with the nose. Now we have the chin cup. Now this chin cup is also referred as the extraoral orthopedic device, and this particular chin cup can be of two type. It can be the occipital or the vertical. So we'll be just discussing that in the upcoming part of the video. Now what will be the function of this chin cup? This will be of course adjusted to the chin, and you can see the anchorage here, right? So this will be the actual anchorage here, right? So any of the occipital or the vertical can be taken as anchorage. So basically the whole function or the whole vector will be moving in this way only, in upward side only, vertical side only. That means it will be restricting the growth of the mandible. So the chin cup are used for restricting the growth of the mandible, as we had the head gears to stop the growth of the maxilla. Same way for the mandible we are going to use the chin cups. Now let's start with the occipital pull chin cup. So we know the occipital pull chin cup will be getting the anchorage from the back of the head. So it would be somewhat like this. This will be your mandible here. This will be the cap here. There will be two components, two steps here to give the occipital pull, right? So the overall vector will be somewhere here. Okay. So that will be restricting the growth of the mandible, right? So derives anchorage from the occipital region of the head, and most commonly used chin cup is the occipital pull chin cup, and it is used in class 3 malocclusion associated with mild or moderate mandibular prognathism. So that will be restricting the growth of the mandible in cases where mild and moderate growth is there. Now the vertical pull chin cup, now that will be deriving the anchorage from the parietal region, right? Parietal region of the head, and it is indicated in patient where the steep mandibular plane angle is there. So steep mandibular plane angle, then you have to go for the vertical pull chin cup, or if you see the excessive anterior facial height, then also you have to go for the vertical pull chin cup, where you will be deriving the anchorage from the parietal region. So what are the force which are required for the treatment? At the time of the appliance delivery, the force will be milder, means lower force will be there, 150 to 300 grams per side, and then after next 2 months, 450 to 700 grams per side is given. Now wearing duration of the appliance is again 12 to 14 hours. So as a rule of thumb, most of the orthopedic appliance are worn for 12 to 14 hours, and that can be a potential question in your exam. Now let's discuss certain frequently asked question. So a lot of image based question can be expected from the headgears also. At the same time, you should know the concepts behind the use of all the headgears here, because this is very conceptual and it can be easily applied here for different malocclusion. So let's see this one. Now this is a face mask, right? Now here you can see this is chin cup and this is head cup, right? Now if it would have been delayer type of face mask, so it would have a square or the rectangular framework, but yes, it doesn't have. It has a tube like framework. Two rods are coming originating from the chin cup and they are merging at the, they are attaching at the forehead cup here, and that gives some space for nose so that there is no interference for the nose. So this is a type of Tubinger face mask. Now this one, this is a face bow. Now there are two type of face bows here. This one is the outer face bow and this one is the inner face bow, and this is the junction of these. Now this will be attached to the buccal part of the maxillary molar where you want to attach the headgear, right? And this can be used as the outer or the face type of the face bow, right? Then we have the chin cup here. Now here you can see this is the chin cup, and this type of anchorage is basically the occipital type of anchorage, or it is called occipital type of chin cup. Now here it will be used in class 3 malocclusion where there is mild to moderate prognathism of the mandible.